Macmillan Audio presents Jack by Marilynne Robinson. Read for you by Adam Verner. To Ellen Levine, my friend and agent for 40 years. He was walking along almost beside her, two steps behind. She did not look back. She said, "I'm not talking to you. I completely understand. If you did completely understand, you wouldn't be following me." He said, "When a fellow takes a girl out to dinner, he has to see her home." "No, he doesn't have to. Not if she tells him to go away and leave her alone." "I can't help the way I was brought up," he said. But he crossed the street and walked along beside her, across the street. When they were a block from where she lived, he came across the street again. He said, "I do want to apologize." "I don't want to hear it. And don't bother trying to explain." "Thank you. I'd rather not try to explain, if that's all right."
"Nothing is all right. All right has no place in this conversation."
Still, her voice was soft. "I understand, of course, but I can't quite resign myself," she said.
"I have never been so embarrassed. Never in my life."
He said, "Well, you haven't known me very long."
She stopped. "Now it's a joke. It's funny," he said.
"There's a problem I have. The wrong things make me laugh. I think I spoke to you about that."
"And where did you come from, anyway? I was just walking along, and there you were behind me."
"Yes, I'm sorry if I frightened you."
"No, you didn't. I knew it was you. No thief could be that sneaky. You must have been hiding behind a tree, something ridiculous."
"Well," he said, "in any case, I have seen you safely to your door." He took out his wallet and extracted a $5 bill.
"Now what is this? Giving me money here on my doorstep? What are people supposed to think about that? You want to ruin my life."
He put the money in the wallet back. "Very thoughtless of me. I just wanted you to know I wasn't ducking out on the check. I know that's what you must think. You see, I did have the money. That was my point." She shook her head.
"Me scraping around in the bottom of my handbag, trying to put together enough quarters and dimes to pay for those pork chops we didn't eat? I left owing the man 20 cents.
"Well, I'll get the money to you. Discreetly. In a book or something. I have those books of yours," he said. "I thought it was a very nice evening. Till the last part. One bad hour out of three. One small personal loan, promptly repaid. Maybe tomorrow," she said.
"I think you expect me to keep putting up with you."
"Not really. People don't, generally. I won't blame you. I know how it is." He said, "Your voice is soft, even when you're angry. That's unusual."
"I guess I wasn't brought up to quarrel in the street."
"I actually meant another kind of soft," he said. "I have a few minutes, if you want to talk this over in private."
"Did you just invite yourself in?" "Well, there's nothing to talk over. You go home, or wherever it is you go. I'm done with this, whatever it is. You're just trouble."
He nodded. "I've never denied it. Seldom denied it, anyway."
"I'll grant you that." They stood there a full minute. He said,
"I've been looking forward to this evening. I don't quite want it to end."
"Mad as I am at you," he nodded.
"That's why I can't quite walk away. I won't see you again, but you're here now," she said.
"I just would not have believed you would embarrass me like that. I still can't believe it."
"Really, it seemed like the best thing at the time."
"I thought you were a gentleman. More or less, anyway."
"Very often, I am. In most circumstances, dyed in the wool much of the time."
"Well, here's my door. You can leave now."
"That's true. I will. I'm just finding it a little difficult. Give me a couple of minutes.
When you go inside, I'll probably leave. If some white people come along, you'll be gone soon enough. He took a step back.
What?
Do you think that's what happened? I saw them, Jack. Those men. I'm not blind and I'm not stupid. He said, I don't know why you're even talking to me. That's what I'd like to know myself. They were just trying to collect some debts. They can be pretty rough about it. I can't risk, you know, an altercation. The last one almost got me 30 days, so that would have embarrassed you, maybe more.
You are something.
Maybe, he said. But I'm not. I'm so glad you told me. I could have left you here thinking. I wouldn't want you to.
The truth isn't so much better, you know. Really?
Yes, it is. Sure it is. So now I'm supposed to forgive you because what you did isn't the absolutely worst thing you could have done? Well, the case could be made, couldn't it? I mean, I feel much better now that we've cleared that up. If I'd walked away 10 minutes ago, think how different it would have been. And then I really never would have seen you again.
Who said you will now?
He nodded. I can't help thinking the odds are better.
Maybe. If I decide to believe you, maybe not.
You really ought to believe me, he said. What harm would it do? You can still hang up on me if I call, return my letters. Nothing would be different. Except you wouldn't have to have such unpleasant thoughts about how you've spent a few hours over a couple of weeks.
That splendid evening we meant to have. You could forgive me that much.
Forgive myself, she said,
for being so foolish.
You could think of it that way, too.
She turned and looked at him. Don't laugh at this, any of this ever, she said.
I think you want to. And if you're trying to be ingratiating, it isn't working. It doesn't work. How well I know. It is some spontaneous, chemical thing that happens. Contact between Jack Boughton and air, like phosphorus, you know? No actual flame, of course. Foxfire. More like that, a rosy heat of embarrassment around any ordinary thing. No way to hide it. I suppose entropy should have a nimbus.
Stop talking, she said.
It's nerves.
I know it is.
Pay no attention.
You're breaking my heart.
He laughed. I'm just talking to keep you here listening. I certainly don't mean to break your heart.
No, you're telling me the truth now. It's a pity. I have never heard of a white man who got so little good out of being a white man.
It has its uses, even for me. I am assumed to know how many bubbles there are in a bar of soap. I've had the honor of helping to make civic dignitaries of some very unlikely chaps.
Don't, she said. Don't. I have to talk about the Declaration of Independence on Monday. There is nothing funny about that.
True. Not a thing, he said. I really am going to say something true, Miss Della. So listen. This doesn't happen every day, then he said. It's ridiculous that a preacher's daughter, a high school teacher, a young woman with excellent prospects in life, would be hanging around with a confirmed inveterate bum. So I won't bother you anymore. You won't be seeing me again.
He took a step away. She looked at him.
You're telling me goodbye.
Why do you get to do that? I told you goodbye, and you've kept me here listening to your nonsense so long, I'd almost forgotten I said it.
Sorry, he said. I see your point. But I was trying to do what a gentleman would do. If a gentleman could actually be in my situation here. I could cost you everything. And there's no good I could ever do you. Well, that's obvious. I'm saying goodbye, so you'll know I understand how things are. I'm actually making you a promise, and I'll stick to it. You'll be impressed.
She said, those books you borrowed?
They'll be on your porch step tomorrow, or soon after, with that money I owe you.
I don't want them back. No, maybe I do.
I suppose you wrote in them. Pencil only. I'll erase it.
No, don't do that. I'll do it.
Yes. I can see that there might be satisfactions involved. Well, she said, I told you goodbye. You told me goodbye. Now walk away. And you go inside. As soon as you're gone. They laughed. After a minute, he said, you just watch. I can do this. And he lifted his hat to her and strolled off with his hands in his pockets. If he did look back, it was after she had closed the door behind her. A week later, when she came home from school, she found her Hamlet lying on the porch step. There were $2 in it, and there was something written in pencil on the inside cover. Had I a blessing, even one, its grace would light on you alone. Had I a single living prayer, it would attend you, mild as air. Had my heart an unbroken string, ring, sing, sting, cling, thing. Oh, I am ill at these numbers. I owe you $1 and a book. Long farewell. Embarrassing. Absolutely the last person in the world. Unbelievable. After almost a year. He snuffed out a cigarette against the headstone. A little carefully, it was only half gone. And what was the point? The smell of smoke must have been what made her stop and look around, look up at him. If he tried to slip back out of sight, that would only frighten her more. So there was nothing left to do but speak to her. Della. There she was, standing in the road on the verge of the lamplight, looking up at him. He could see in her stillness the kind of hesitation that meant she was held there by uncertainty about whether she did know him or was only seeing a resemblance, and in any case, whether to walk away, suppressing the impulse to run away if whoever he was, even he himself, seemed threatening or strange. Well, let's be honest, he was strange, loitering in a cemetery in the dark of night, no doubt about it. But she might be pausing there, actually hoping she did know him, ready for anything at all like reassurance. So he lifted his hat and said, good evening, Miss Smiles, if I'm not mistaken. She put her hand to her face as if to compose herself. Yes, she said, good evening. There were tears in her voice. So he said, Jack Bowden. She laughed, tears in her laughter. Of course, I mean, I thought I recognized you. It's so dark I couldn't be sure. Looking into the dark makes it darker, harder to see anything. I didn't realize they locked the gates, I just didn't think of it.
Yes, it depends where you're standing, how dark it is. It's relative. My eyes are adjusted to it, so I guess that makes light relative, doesn't it?
Embarrassing.
He meant to sound intelligent, since he hadn't shaved that morning and his tie was rolled up in his pocket. She nodded and looked down the road ahead of her, still deciding.
How had he recognized her? He had spent actual months noticing women who were in any way like her, until he thought he had lost the memory of her and all that seeming resemblance.
A coat like hers, a hat like hers. Sometimes the sound of a voice made him think he might see her if he turned. A bad idea. Her laughing meant she must be with someone. She might not want to show that she knew him. He would walk on, a little slower than the crowd, with the thought that as she passed, she would speak to him if she wanted to, ignore him if she wanted to. Once or twice he stopped to look in a store window to let her reflection go by. And there were only the usual strangers, that endless stream of them. Cautious as he was, sometimes women took his notice as a familiarity they did not welcome. A useful reminder. A look like that would smart, he thought, coming from her. Still, all this waiting, if that's what it was, helped him stay sober and usually reminded him to shave. It might really be her sometime. And if he tipped his hat, shaven and sober, she would be more likely to smile. But there she was, in the cemetery, of all places, and at night, and ready to be a little glad to see him. Yes, he said. I've noticed that. About darkness. Join me in it. Even things up. I am the Prince of Darkness. He couldn't say that. It was a joke he made to himself. He would walk down to where she was, in the lamplight. No. Any policeman who came by might take it into his head to say the word solicitation, since he was disreputable and she was black. Since they were together.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.